Greetings, fellow film fans. Thanks for tuning in. My name is Mercy and this is the Funny Pajamas YouTube channel. Now it's that time of the week again. I know I'm a little late than my usual posting, but it's that time of the week again when we discuss WandaVision. Now WandaVision's latest episode dropped by the time I'm releasing this video about 2 days prior, and I didn't get to put up my review as quick as I had hoped to, but this episode had so much packed in it that I just had to discuss it. So this is the spoiler heavy. Please make a note. As I have said clearly in the title, this is a spoiler heavy discussion of WandaVision episode 4. So, and listen, while you're at it, before I forget, why don't you please hit that, smash that like button, hit that beautiful red subscribe button, become a subscriber to my channel if you haven't done so already. Don't forget to hit the bell icon so that you're notified every time I post something new. With all that down and out of the way, let's get down straight into the meat of the matter. Now, WandaVision episode 4 starts off with a totally different tone compared to the previous episodes, for which I will admit I am a bit grateful. Though I did enjoy the previous episodes and their sitcom-y feel, I did want to hear more, and this episode as a basic setup or is sort of like a exposition episode. So we start off post the blip. Soon after the blip is over and people have, the snap has been undone, people are materializing again, we find Monica Rambeau in a hospital room. Now we soon find out that she was originally there with her mother, Mariah Rambeau, who by the way is Captain Marvel's best friend. And now Mariah Rambeau apparently had cancer, she had just been cleared. And Monica Rambeau, from what we gather from the story, was about to check her out when the blip happened. And as we know, in the MCU, half the universe's population was snapped out of existence. Now, but what we find out further ahead is that Mariah Rambeau actually, in fact, the cancer returned, and she unfortunately wasn't able to be saved, and she passes away. And this all happens while Monica Rambeau, she was so far under the name of Geraldine, but we now know that she's actually Monica Rambeau. All this happens during the 5 years that Monica Rambeau disappeared because of the snap. Now, once she comes back, she's shocked to hear that her mother's passed away. And this kind of gives us a view. So far, we all got the happy news of what happens, how people were so happy that the snap was undone. But we also see now that immediately after the snap, the chaos that ensued. As you see in the hospital room, people are appearing all over, patients are appearing and all that sort of stuff. So there's chaos all over. And in the midst of all this, Monica Rambeau has to come to terms with the fact that her mother is no longer with her, and she sort of got cheated from saying her goodbyes to her mother. So that's where we pick off. So it's kind of like a, we get the meat of the matter, we sink our teeth into it, and then we find a month later that Monica Rambeau goes over to SWORD, and that's when we find out that SWORD, that Monica Rambeau is actually an agent for SWORD. She works for them, and that SWORD was in fact set up by Mariah Rambeau. Now, Mariah Rambeau, I guess in this, is pretty much like the Peggy Carter. Like Peggy Carter was for S.H.I.E.L.D. I'm guessing Mariah Rambeau was for SWORD. So, 5 years passed, post the blip, Monica comes back to work after a month after the blip has been reversed. And she's like the first person to report, and she finds out that she's grounded. She finds out that, she can't go up. What I'm assuming was space missions. They give us a brief discussion of how SWORD no longer undertakes manned missions but sends more drones, artificial intelligence and that sort of stuff. So we see that Monica Rambeau finds out that she's grounded, that she can't fly. So I'm assuming she was some sort of astronaut or a pilot or some such. And she's given a very mundane job. She's sent to look into a missing person report. So off she heads off to New Jersey and the town of Westview, where there seems to be a missing persons report. Now at this point, she meets up with FBI agent James Wu. Now Jimmy Wu, or James Wu, is you will clearly recognize him. He comes in the Ant-Man and the Wasp movie. And it's cool how he introduces himself with a little card trick that he learned from Scott. So that's how they introduce, and he tells her that it's actually not a case of a missing person. It's more like the case of a missing town itself. And this is the town of Westview. People around don't seem to know that the town exists, that it even ever existed, or the people over there existed. And the people from around seem to, you know, they have no awareness of it. And that's when Monica Rambeau says, okay, let's go check it out. She sends forward a drone. Okay. And the drone is in the small helicopter shape. Now, this helicopter shape is not the same as the helicopter. This is like, it is very basic design, very similar to the helicopter that turned up in episode 2. Now, episode 2, we saw it's all in black and white. And there's this red and yellow helicopter with a sword symbol on it. So I'm guessing this is, as we see further ahead, objects, once they enter the town, they seem to morph to suit the reality that the town is under at that moment, be it the 50s, the 60s, 70s, or so on forth. So Monica sends in the drone, and the drone just disappears through the force field. That's when they realize there's a force field there. Now, throwing caution to the wind, Monica just reaches out and she gets sucked into the force field. So the sort of the energy field or the force field as such. Now fast forward 24 hours beyond that, and SWORD has brought in all its experts, it's brought in huge amounts of personnel. It's like a joint venture, not only with SWORD but the FBI and all sorts of organizations. And we are introduced once again to Darcy Lewis. Now Darcy Lewis, well, pretty I liked her. I liked her role in the Thor movie. She plays an intern to Jane Foster. And we see by now she's got her PhD in astrophysics, and since she's learned from pretty much the best, she has a good grasp on the subject. She is brought in to consult along with a whole other group of specialists, and we see from her witty conversation, she's able to find out that SWORD basically has no idea what they're dealing with. So she comes in and she meets up with James Wu, and she sets up her equipment and stuff. And that's when she picks up these signals. And she says, okay, these radiation signals. And she's sort of like, she asks the guy who's, you know, helping her out, get me a TV, like a real old one. Now, one which is not flat. And I thought it was pretty funny. So they bring one with a real CRT, you know, the old-fashioned TVs. And she hooks it up, and WandaVision, like we watched the first 3 episodes, the very same thing starts to play. So it's like Wanda and Vision are in a sitcom. So the guys at SWORD are pretty stumped. They're like, what the heck is this? A sitcom starring 2 Avengers? They may, you know? And soon they start to unravel things, and then they start to identify the people that are in the sitcom as people who have actually in the real world gone missing, whose location is unknown. So this, you know, sort of solidifies the theory that yes, it is actually real people within the town of Westview. They are not all conjured up by Wanda. So they're pretty much people there. Now the question is, are they there willingly or are they there against their will? From what we hear from Herb, he's like, remember the previous episode, the neighbor guy Herb, he's gardening, and he and Agnes are like, they're discussing something, and they tell Vision, Geraldine's not from here, we are all here for, and then they stop. So I'm guessing they have like a semi-conscious knowledge that they are there. Are they being held against their will, or are they there willingly? Do they not know anything? Are they being harmed in any way? This all that they don't really answer in this episode, but that keeps us hoping and hooked on for more next episode. So as they find out, they start identifying all these characters and putting up their names on a pin board, you know, and stuff like that. And then one thing you notice, the one person whose name, two people actually, one is Dottie and one is Agnes. Though Dottie's picture is not there on the board, Agnes's picture is there. While all the other characters who appear episodes, while their faces, they're able to identify them with driver's license and stuff, Agnes, you will notice, that is played by Catherine Hahn, does not have an identity, or they haven't been able to identify her. Now, maybe further on ahead they will, but I'm guessing here, like, a lot of talk and chatter has been going on the net that maybe she's Agatha Harkness. So maybe that's also working in, because she does seem to be a pretty key character, and she does seem to be knowing a lot more about what's going on than she seems to be letting on. So these are all theories going ahead. Now, meanwhile, there's like really funny moments between Darcy and Jimmy Woo. Jimmy Woo is being played by Randall Park. If you haven't seen Fresh Off the Boat, go check it out. It's a nice serial. So that's pretty, he turns up in that. And I always love wherever he pops up. He's got that really comedic timing that's so perfect. And his expressions and all. Oh, he's priceless. And Kat Dennings as Darcy Lewis also plays off his comedic timings really well. I really liked her character in both the Thor movies, and I was waiting for her to turn up again. So I'm pretty glad to see these two characters, and I loved what they brought to this episode. This episode was on the whole a bit heavy, very information heavy, and I will admit they managed to balance this various moods and situations well, because in this episode there were some very, very dark moments. I will get to that later. But there were some very dark moments, and the creators of this show have been able to balance it really well, all the while giving us a good idea of everything. So this whole episode takes place as in through the eyes of the people on the other side of this force field, or outside of the town of Westview, and how they're trying to figure it out. So these SWAT guys decide, okay, we'll send someone in. So they send someone in a hazmat suit climbing through the sewers into enter the town of Westview. But once he passes the boundary, his hazmat suit sort of morphs into the beekeeper suit, and that's the beekeeper we see the end of episode 2 in WandaVision. So he comes out of the manhole, and he just, you know, we have that moment, and we see that whenever Wanda resets what's going on in the WandaVision show in her reality, whenever she resets it, rewinds it and resets it, that doesn't show up on the SWORD's television. Now, by now they're recording all these things. They've got a whole lot of old-fashioned, you know, TVs up, and they're watching this sitcom as it plays out. And we see that they're recording it and studying it, taking notes and stuff like that. And they notice that every time there are cuts, and these cuts coincide with whenever Wanda resets something or changes something. So this clearly gives us an idea that Wanda has control, pretty much a good control of it. Though she does seem to lose it at certain parts. So they move ahead. Wanda, we are shown how Monica Rambeau is cast at the end of the last episode. We saw she's cast out of Westview, and we are brought back to that scene between her and Wanda, and Wanda goes straight out batshit crazy. She looks so scary, like almost like when she faced off with Thanos. And you gotta think of this from Wanda's perspective, because when we were in Infinity War, in the beginning of Infinity War, she wanted to settle down, you know, with Vision, and they kind of had their own life away from everyone else, and they were pretty much, you know, they wanted a happy life together as a couple. And then come in Infinity War, she not only sees Vision die twice before her, but the very first time she's forced to do it herself. Now he's probably the only person outside her family that she really loved. She lost her entire family. She lost her twin brother. And now she was forced to kill Vision. And then Thanos steps in, reverses, brings him back and kills him again in front of her. The amount of emotional and mental trauma that this goes through is enough to break a person. And I'm guessing that's what happens here. She is not alright when this is going on. I'm guessing she's gone really crazy. And she set up this world. This is her way to cope. Now, is Vision really Vision? Or is he a conjured up construct or such? That we don't know. And I'm interested to see how they pursue it further on ahead. Now, I do have a few theories. I have a feeling they're going to go all out and make Wanda, that is Scarlet Witch, the antagonist of this series. And the next few episodes, I feel, are going to be from the view of Vision, trying to figure it out, trying to understand what's going on. Because you see in these episodes, particularly when Vision talks to Wanda, after Wanda has cast out Geraldine, that is Monica Rambeau. And she casts her out and she just repairs the wall, and it's like she sets everything back to normal. And Vision walks in, and that's when you get Corpse Vision. You know, Vision, like how he was dead, like totally monochromatic with the glassy eyes and the, you know, the half missing forehead and all that, you know, like with the, where the soul stone was, which was plucked out by Thanos. So you see Vision like that, and that's one scary visual, especially how they transition. There's absolutely no warning for that, and that Corpse Vision is pretty scary. And I, for one, who do not have a big affinity for horror films, I was pretty scared. And Wanda is like, no, no. And then she looks back again and she brings him back to his original form. That's all purpley. And Vision's like, Wanda, we can leave here. We can go anywhere we want. And Wanda is like, no, this is our home. We'll stay here. I have it all under control. And just as Monica Rambeau's shot out of the force field and out of the town of Westview, when she rolls and lands and the people come and the agents of SWORD and all the agencies come forward to check her out, and all she says, it's Wanda. It's all Wanda. So I'm guessing here Wanda's like lost it totally now. She's created this pocket dimension, and I have a feeling she's going to be the antagonist moving on ahead. I have a feeling they're going to end this with her being an antagonist. And we know Scarlet Witch is going to make an appearance in Doctor Strange 2. I'm guessing she could be the villain of Doctor Strange 2. Since we're all going to be exploring the multiverse, and rightfully so, since Doctor Strange 2 has been titled Multiverse of Madness, I'm guessing she's going to be the villain. And the rest of the episodes that are in this season of WandaVision, maybe there's going to be another season, maybe not, I don't know. But the rest of the episodes, I have a feeling, is about Vision trying to figure out, and Vision being basically the protagonist. But if you ask me, I think Vision is really dead, and at the end of the show, Wanda's going to have to come to face facts. The guy she loved is dead, and I don't know how she's going to handle that. Now, overall, this show had many interesting facets, and it really shed light on stuff. I liked how they gave us an idea of how they introduced Monica Rambeau's past and what she has undergone, and how they picked up immediately after the blip. And I also liked how they explained all matters, how they brought it all together. Now, so far, people have been on and off about the first three episodes. Now, this episode gives us more of a, you know, of an MCU feel. The previous episodes have been bonkers crazy. Will they continue with this, or will they jump heavily back into the sitcom feel? Now, many would say that they were too invested in the sitcom feel. I don't know where I am on this right now. I do think they leaned heavily on the sitcom feel, but it wasn't too much. I enjoyed it. I've had fun with it. But if they do go further ahead into the sitcom and lean even more heavily on it in the further episodes to come, I gotta say, you're gonna lose me a bit. Now, this episode did a good job of hooking me. Like I said, the last episode, if you haven't seen my reviews for the past three episodes, go check them out. They're up on my channel. If you see my reviews, you see that the last episode, I was hooked. I really loved it. And this episode blew my mind. This is what a person comes to the MCU for. This is the kind of fair that general MCU fans tend to visit and watch MCU content for. So, I am interested. I love this episode. I liked it for what it gave us, a good context, all within the basic, and they managed to balance all the feels of the movie, of the series. At 1 minute, it's quirky, funny, and, you know, laugh out loud, crazy and charming. At the end, another moment, it is dark and dramatic, and I thought that they brought that balance out really well. I do think this is the better. Like the previous episodes, not that much. The last episode, a little better than the first two. This episode is so far my favorite. I am interested to see how they go further ahead. Now, there are theory is going out right, left, center about there being Mephisto involved. Now, Mephisto is a character I don't know much about, but I'm not so sure. But the only reason I would suggest is I would look at that, not throw away that theory, is basically because, I mean, Monica Rambeau straight out says it's Wanda, it's all Wanda. It's a bit too early for that. There's another question. Who is Catherine Hahn's character, Agnes, actually? I have a feeling there's more going on to her. Now, these are just my theories and my fan ravings about this, about what I've got so far. I'm enjoying it. It only seems to be getting better and better. And I do hope it gets better. They really seem to be setting us up with lots of intrigue and mystery. And they seem to be promising a payoff. Now, I hope they manage to deliver on that payoff. Because if they set us up so much and the ending and the payoff is like lackluster, it's really going to lose people. And it's not the way, you know, Marvel wants to kick off phase 4. I do hope the payoff's great. I do hope it's amazing. This episode did two important things. It really gave, you know, it gave us meat, matter. It gave us an understanding of what's going on. At the same time, there are so many questions that we haven't got answered. You know, we don't know what's really going on. There are so many more questions that are popping up all over. And that just makes me all the more excited to watch this. Did you guys enjoy this episode more than the previous episodes? Or was it the other way around? Do you want to go back into the sitcom feel? I hope they cut between the real world, that is the world outside Westview, and the sitcom-y feel. I hope they don't lean too heavily on the sitcom-y feel. Though I am interested to see how they portray the 80s, the 90s and the 2000s. So I am interested in that. And going forward, I do believe they're going to be... Feige did say that they have plans for Monica Rambeau's character. Now, Monica Rambeau in the comics was Photon, who was also a superhero. She got a she's also has superpowers. Maybe through this, you know, when she was kicked out of the field, she was... It could have given her, imbued some powers in her. Let's see, hoping on moving further ahead. We know she's going to make an appearance in Captain Marvel 2 along with Kamala Khan, who is Miss Marvel. So I'm interested to see where this goes, how this heads. I'm loving every moment of what I've got so far. I hope you are too. Listen, you can always, you know, contact me simply at @mercy_d on Twitter, on Instagram @mercy_sd, or the Funny Pajamas Facebook page is always there for you to visit, simply on Facebook @funny.pajamas. And you can always send me an email simply @mercy@funny-pajamas. That's pajamas with a Y, by the way. Waiting to hear from you guys. And by the way, Funny Pajamas has its own webpage, so go check it out. I put on editorials, reviews, stuff like that. Love to hear from you. Get your comments, read your stuff. Hit the comment section down below. Let me know what you think. The website is www.funny-pajamas.com. Pajamas with a Y. Be sure to hit the comment section down below. Let me know what you think. I want to hear your theories. What are your theories? Do you agree with my theories? Where are you on it? Do you think Wanda is going to become, you know, go all out evil and become the villain? I know they're drawing from House of M. I do not know exactly. I haven't read The House of M. I just know what I've done from research. So I just want to see what they're giving me. Kevin Feige, give me more. Give me more Marvel goodness. I'm going to end it with that. That's all I have for you right now. Be sure to check in next week when I review the next episode. Hoping it's as good as this one. Hoping it's as amazing as this one. That's all I have for you right now. This is Mercy signing out. Bye. Have a good one.